Hi everyone, I'm Gilles Requena, the Chief Patent Research and Policy Officer of the European Patent Office, and I'm very pleased to welcome you to the second webinar organized by the EPO Observatory on Patents and Technology. Our first event in October on intellectual property boosting startups attracted a lot of interest, and I was told that you are already hundreds connected today to follow our webinar on carbon capture and storage, a new frontier in clean tech. This is no surprise because the potential of carbon capture and storage technologies, the so-called CCS, supporting the fight against climate change, a global priority, is debated in so many forums nowadays. This week, 121 countries signed the Global Pledge on Renewables and Energy Efficiency, jointly launched by the EU and COP28 presidency, with very ambitious targets, including the tripling of current renewable energy capacity by the end of the decade. These major transitions will necessitate a wide range of actions, from adapting individual behaviors until major industrial transformation. This will request huge investments from both public and private actors alike and the development of innovative solutions. Just this week, Breakthrough Energy Catalyst, the clean tech investment organization funded by Bill Gates, announced a 240 million funding with the European Investment Bank and the European Commission on CCS. One of these projects concerns EnergyDome, an Italian startup that processes CO2 in batteries by pulling it from storage, pressuring it, and releasing it through a turbine back into energy supply to the grid. Solutions like this capture CO2 and store it efficiently, and even use it as a source of energy. Being a responsible organization, the EPO has invested for some time in order to make our own activities more carbon neutral. But can we do more? The EPO receives nowadays almost 200,000 patent applications per year, covering all kinds of technical inventions, including new CCS technologies. We have the largest patent databases in the world with more than 140 million documents. We are at the forefront of the technological development and can therefore help measure the progress made to achieve the goals of the European Green Deal and the Paris Agreement. But how can we facilitate the access to this wealth of knowledge for a large scientist community? Well, we just launched a few days ago the new CCS section of our clean energy platform, freely accessible on our website. And in a moment, our specialist in patent knowledge, Christian Soltmann, will provide you with a brief introduction. It will be followed by a presentation of the main technological trends in the CCS inventions, with facts and figures collected from our databases. Our in-house experts in CCS technologies, Marco Gruber, will help to shed a light on the current landscape in Europe and beyond. Finally, and this is the main part of our webinar, a panel of four experts representing various fields of the CCS industry, research, and policy community will engage in a lively discussion on the role of financial mechanisms, technology integration, and a regulatory framework in transforming CCS in a game changer. Many thanks again to the panelists for their participation to our event. I hope you will enjoy it. We have just 1 hour in total, so without further ado, let's start with the first presentation. Christian, the floor is yours. Thank you.
Many thanks. In this brief presentation, we will provide an introduction to the new section on CCS technologies on the EPO's Clean Energy Platform. The Clean Energy Platform forms part of a series of technology platforms that facilitate access to patent information on relevant technologies. For those of you who are not familiar with the expression, patent information is essentially the set of all information collected and made available during application and granting procedures for patents and utility models worldwide. It's a very rich source of information and very useful for you, be it at your workplace or in the laboratory, because it supports you in collecting technical information, in supporting informed decision-making during all stages of the product and development process. And with that, basically, it increases the likelihood that you will be successful on the market with your product and service. patent information also helps to form opinions and support decision-making in other areas. It's helpful for academics and researchers, and it's also very helpful for data analysis, for example, when combined with other sources of information. Today, the PO alone has already information on more than 140 million patent documents from applications from all continents, from more than 100 patent authorities. It's technical information, so patent documents published during the application and granting procedures, but also procedural information, which helps you to understand what happened during the application and granting procedure and after an IP right was granted or registered. Estimates suggest that 80% of all technical information is only in patent documents and nowhere else. It's an extremely rich source of information, and we can only encourage you to use it. The European Patent Office looks back on a long tradition of making this information useful, for example, by providing patent information in high quality via its EPO patent information products and services, such as the free of charge search interface Espacenet. The EPO also provides added value information to support you in understanding the context, the information, and benefit from it. There are also publications such as the Chief Economist Studies and Insight Reports on relevant technologies. And last but not least, the EPO creates and maintains platforms such as the Deep Tech Finder platform and the technology platforms. You can see here the three platforms that have been published already. It started with the Fighting Coronavirus platform in 2020. It was updated already twice. The second platform is the SAT Clean Energy platform, and the last published this year is the Firefighting Technology platform. Of particular interest to you may be the content of the Clean Energy platform. More than 50 search concepts on relevant technologies have been created and are maintained by subject matter experts of the European Patent Office. The information is grouped into three subsections: on renewable energy technologies, on technologies related to reducing the carbon footprint of carbon-intensive industries such as the steel and the cement industry, and there's another area for energy storage technologies and other enabling technologies. This platform was launched in November last year, and as Gilles mentioned already, it was extended by a section on CCS technologies, and this is the focus of the presentation today. You can access this platform using the link you can see on this slide. And if you do that, basically you will arrive at the landing page of the platform. You can see here that it starts with introductory text. I just navigate through the landing page. Additional information, such as information on the update with the extension to the CCS technologies this week. You can see the subsections. You can click on it to navigate to the relevant search concept and other important information, such as the relationship with the Sustainable Development Goals. CCS technologies are covered in the area of energy storage and other enabling technologies. If you click on it, you will see again a landing page now for the sub area with an introduction, context information, and much more. And the search concepts for this area are grouped to so-called accordions. So you see here electrolyzers for hydrogen production, energy storage, and then last but not least, of course, CCS technologies. You can activate this accordion by clicking on the plus label, and then you see which search concepts have been created for you. There are two areas, carbon capture and carbon storage. You can see there's already a wide variety for carbon capture, one for carbon storage, and of course the EPO is ambitious to maintain this information and possibly extend it further. For each of these search concepts, such as, for example, adsorption-related technologies, you see that you can reach the most recent inventions, so those which have been published in the last years, or the full data set, which is more comprehensive. And for each of these options, you can also activate the statistics function to see, for example, who are the main applicants or the main inventors. Let's assume you're interested in adsorption and the most recent inventions. You can click on it, and then in the background, the search is executed for you, which was developed by subject matter experts, and you see the results in the EPO's free of charge tool, Espacenet. You can filter the results, you can have a closer look, download documents, and do much more. Use the functionality of Espacenet we have created for you. And with that, we hope that you can have an easy access to patent information in that area. It's an extremely rich source, and we can only invite you to use the platform, tailor the searches to your own needs, and tap the benefits from the information. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you. Thank you, Christian. I hope I'm visible on screen, and I will share my screen for a short presentation on patent activities in the area of CCC. Now, what I'm going to do is to give a couple of information about the activity per technology used for CCS. I go over the evolution of these concepts over time. I give you an indication about the global geographical distribution of those activities, and also have a look at the top 10 applicants in the field of CCS. I conclude this short intervention with the activities of startups in Europe. Now, I would like to start with a short summary of what there is on in terms of technologies for separating CO2 from gas stream. We have absorption and adsorption, which are extraction concepts. The first one using a liquid solvent, and the second one is solid bed sorbent material. There are biological concepts for removing CO2. And we also have use of chemical reactions to separate CO2 from gas stream. There are also concepts using deep temperature condensation, which are called cryogenic concept, and we can use membranes to separate CO2. Carbon storage basically comes down to injecting CO2 underground or below the seabed. Mouse didn't work. Now, if we look at the filing activity per technological concept, what we are using is the number of international patent families. These are patents which have been filed and published at several patent offices, which is a reliable proxy for the quality of a patent, because the inventor thought his invention was valid enough, in fact, to seek international protection for it. So what we do not look at is national filing numbers, because they may distort slightly the picture. Now, if we look at this bar chart, what we see is that the first two, the extraction concepts, physical solvent extraction and solid bed adsorption, are clearly leading with almost 2,700 filings over the last 24, 25 years. Nearly half of that has been filed for the separation using membranes, a little less for chemical concepts, and roughly a third of the two extraction concepts has been filed for cryogenic separation. Now, what you also see is that for the concept relating to the storage of CO2, there are relatively little there is relatively little activity compared to the others. One reason for that may be that the vast majority of CO2 which has been separated is actually not stored underground, but used in a concept that's called enhanced oil recovery. For that concept, you inject carbon dioxide in liquid form under high pressure in existing oil wells in order to push out, in fact, remaining oil and gas in the rock formation. So that may explain why there hasn't been so much activity yet for concepts that aim at sequestering, for good actually, CO2 in the ground.
That's where.
If you look at the evolution of patent activities over time and look at this graph, what we see is that the two concepts in the lead are also here represented by the top two graphs. And what's interesting to observe is that there is a peak in the years between 2010 and 2014. Now, one possible reason for that could be that in the time, the concept of hydraulic fracking and also enhanced oil recovery was discovered. Oil and gas companies had an incentive, in fact, to procure carbon dioxide. And what they did was they looked for gas streams with a higher concentration of that gas, which basically is the flue gas emitted from power generation plants or from industry plants. If we look at how patent filing activities for CCS concepts is spread globally, now what we see is that in the United States, we have a high activity, far higher in fact than compared to other areas in the world, with more than 2,000 filings. Now, less than half of that has been filed in Japan, roughly 850. And then comes Europe with Germany, France, with respective almost 700 and 500 filings. What we can also notice is that China may perhaps be surprisingly less active compared to others. But again, we look here at numbers for international patent families, which does not represent, in fact, the activity on national level. So internal filings, which may be much higher than what we see for the international patent families. Now, if we look at who is actually the most active filer in the technology worldwide, we have here a compilation of the top 10 applicants. And what we see is indeed what we've just seen on the previous slide. So the geographical distribution is also translated into the type of applicants you see. The United States represented with four companies, ExxonMobil, General Electric, Air Products, and Honeywell. Europe is represented by Air Liquide and Institut Français de Pétrole for France, BASF and Linde for Germany. We also have a Japanese applicant, Mitsubishi, and Shell represents the UK and the Netherlands. What we see as well is that the two companies, Shell and ExxonMobil, are major oil and gas companies, which have an interest in filing here for the reasons I explained before. Now, if we look at the names of those companies, you may wonder whether perhaps younger, more recent companies, perhaps even startups, could join the ranks of the top applicants. Now, we need to go into a specific technology of carbon capture, which is the physical solid bed adsorption. And here we see that among the top 10, there is a startup, Climeworks. Climeworks is a Swiss company that works with solid bed adsorption and has a number of operations running in Iceland. Now, speaking about startups, you may be interested also what's going on in Europe in the area of CCS. Now, this slide shows the number of startups that file patents in the CCS area. And what we see is perhaps limited activity in filing patents. We talk about single-digit numbers for the various countries in Europe. Now, as for the reasons of why there isn't more, it may be that perhaps one of our panel members, can answer that question. The panel discussion is the next point of our agenda. The panel discussion will be moderated by Victor Veefkind. Victor is a member of the Chief Economist Unit at the EPO. And with that, I would like to thank you and hand over to Victor.
Yes. Thank you so much, Marco. I will wait for the panelists maybe to also come on screen. Okay, that is going great. Just two more. Yep. Okay, we're just missing the last panelist, Chris.
You are missing me because apparently
we can see you now. I think we're all complete. Thanks so much. Thanks also to Marco. We arrived to what I would say is the main event today, which is a panel discussion on CCS. I think we have four excellent panelists. Each is an expert in their own area. A warm welcome to you again. I will introduce each of the panelists during the course of the discussion to the audience. Before that, I would like to again draw the attention to the Q&A session. You can ask questions to the panelist, and you can do that using the Q&A function of Zoom. At the bottom of your screen, you will see a small Q&A button, and if you click on that, this will allow you to ask questions. Now, we've heard in the previous presentations about what CCS is a little bit. It's about capture and storage or sequestration of CO2. We've seen some patenting trends. I would say there's an intriguing pattern. There's a bump, a bit of a valley, and then a sharp recent rise. We've seen what the predominant countries and companies are. And also, we've identified European startups with patents in the field. This is easy using the Deep Tech Finder. Marco showed a slide on that already. And we've also seen that although they're there, they're not extremely abundant. And what I would like to do in the coming panel discussion is to reflect a little bit on CCS itself as a technology, some of the surrounding policy issues, and also the role of startups and innovation in this particular area. And I would like to kick off the panel discussion with a few questions to our first panelists, which is Paul Fennell. Paul is a professor of clean energy at Imperial College of London, where he's also the president of the Chemical Engineering Society. Paul, the International Energy Agency recently noted that most of the plant capture capacity to 2050 in the net zero emission scenario is in applications that are still at the demonstration stage or below, and that research and development seems crucial to bridge this gap and to continue to reduce cost and energy penalty of the CCS. So innovation is clearly very important in this area. And with this in mind, would you be able to tell us a little bit more about the main technology breakthroughs that are there?
Okay, thank you. Are you getting me clearly?
Yep.
Good. I think I would say that deployment of the first generation of technologies is probably the most important thing that will happen. That will drive the innovation in the second generation, in the advanced carbon capture technologies, because there is an issue at the moment that there has been a lack of deployment of basic systems, which means that there isn't a sort of ecosystem of people going out there and saying, right, well, you know, CCS has been demonstrated. CCS is important. And, it is actually energy intensive. So we need to drive down on the energy costs. So what I think will probably happen first will be that the advanced CCS technologies will be solvent based. Because the majority of the deployments that are happening, the large pilots are being solvent-based. So I think that we know how to do solvent scrubbing, and we've been doing it for decades. So I think that we'll start out by doing something that we find easy and which banks will give guarantees on. Then we'll move on to the newer types of things. I think I'm going to be controversial again and say that CO2 capture from the air is a complete distraction. I think it requires three times more energy to capture CO2 from the air than it takes to capture from a power station or a cement plant. So there's a lot of work going into that, but I think that really we have to deploy power and cement, steel, CCS first before we start thinking about capturing CO2 from the air. And in the terms of sorbents, that sort of stuff, I mean, people have been working on those for you know, years. I've got a patent that is now 12 years old, so it's no real use to man nor beast anymore. And there'll be lots of different classifications, lots of different ways you can capture the CO2. Key things will be that they're either very cheap or have extremely long lifetimes. They have to not be able to escape from the process in any real manner, particularly if they have toxic elements in them. And they have to be significantly resistant to poisoning, because there's going to be, you know, tiny residual amounts of sulfur, etc., and all sorts of horrible nasties in all streams that are trying to capture CO2 from. So long term, they'll get poisoned. But one of the key things, again, is because these things are so huge, the scrubbing systems are going to be so huge that you really have to think about what's going to be exiting your system, even in what look like very small quantities, because small quantities times massive, massive systems become potential for an environmental issue. Not that it's definitely going to happen. People do scrub things. People are very careful about these things. But people that are inventing things maybe are not the same as people that are using them at the large scale. Perhaps the company patents will be more careful about these sorts of things. So I'll draw a breath now. Thanks very much.
Thank you. Just if you've spoken about like the first generation deployment as being very, very important. Mm-hmm. We also seem to perceive like a new wave of innovations in mm-hmm. the last couple of years. Is there anything in there that you can point at as, oh, wow, this is something new. This is something that could have a great future.
Look, there's good ideas in the first generation. There's good ideas in the second generation, the second wave of patents. The key thing is that they need to move forwards. I mean, I will say that there are lots and lots of different advanced technologies, advanced processes, calcium chemical looping, advanced solvents, membranes. You know, there's lots of really cool technologies out there, and my view is that they, you know, there'll be a wave of deployment, hopefully, touch wood, of solvent based systems, and then there will be a competition in the market between all of the various different technologies, and it would be foolish to choose one particular technology until they have had a chance to actually compete on economics. There's so many different possible ways of capturing CO2 and so many different sets of research that's going on that picking one and saying this is the way forwards potentially is a challenge. Obviously, I'm going to say calcium looping because that's what I've been working on for 15 years, and other than that, possibly membranes.
Okay, thank you so much, Paul. I would then like to introduce our next panelist, which is Viola Beccatini. She's head of business development at Neustark AG, which is a startup that specializes in sequestering CO2. They have developed and are patenting new solutions to permanently store CO2 in recycled material waste, such as demolished concrete. Viola, can you maybe shortly explain what your company does in a few minutes?
Of course. So Neustark is a carbon dioxide removal company. So we deliver CDR, and we start with sourcing carbon dioxide from mostly biogas upgrading plants. So it's biogenic CO2, meaning that plants have absorbed this CO2 during their growth phase, and then organic residues are used to produce biogas. So the CO2 is already being separated by the biogas plant operator. So what we need to do is just liquefy the CO2. We transport it to a concrete recycling facility. And this such facility collects demolition concrete, which is crushed usually, and then is processed to produce new concrete. So what we do, we expose this concrete granulates to the pure CO2 that we have transported to the site, and the CO2 gets permanently mineralized in this aggregate. So ultimately, it's permanently stored, and after the reaction has taken place, the carbonated aggregates can be used to produce new concrete or for road construction. So ultimately, the CO2 is stored in building materials.
Okay, so actually, the concrete that you or let's say the material that you make is it can be completely reused again as concrete with similar properties as the original concrete. Is that correct?
Exactly. And we have done, we collaborate with the Swiss Federal Institute of Materials. They have done extensive research on how the properties of this aggregate change after carbonation. And they have seen that actually the properties of the new concrete you produce are even improved. So the compressive strength increases. And this gives the opportunity to decrease the amount of cement for the production of concrete, and being cement, the most the ingredient of concrete with the highest environmental impact, there is an additional benefit there.
Oh, cool. Then maybe another question. So relatively speaking, there seem to be not that many startups in Europe, at least not with a patent application. Do you think that is a difficult field to start a company in, CCS as such?
That's a very difficult question. I would say that the field itself has increased a lot in the most recent years. So there are definitely more and more startups coming to the field, especially for direct air capture, new approaches for CO2 mineralization. So I would say there could be more in the next years for sure.
Okay, well, that's hopeful, I would say. So your company actually does show up on our deep tech finder, meaning that you have a European patent or patent application. In your experience, does having patents or patent applications help you to get more support?
For sure. I think like the advantage of having, we have three patent applications. I think the advantage is twofold, right? So to one end, of course, having a patent protects you from competitors and from them developing a similar approaches, but it surely gives also more credibility and trust and security towards investors and customers. So it's definitely a plus, yes. Of course, it doesn't guarantee that then you get an investor, but it for sure helps.
Yeah, thank you. I think this is also what we hear a lot, that it sort of increases credibility a little bit with respect to people who want to invest in your company. Yeah. What in when speaking about your company, what are our next step in what you would like to do? Is there something else technically you would like to do, or are you focusing really on more the business side?
So what we have done so far, we have focused on technologies to mineralize the CO2 and this demolition concrete aggregates, but also in concrete mixing water. So what happens is when concrete is transported, so the demolition concrete is transported to the recycling facility. Usually the trucks are washed with water, and this water contains a lot of calcium oxide particles. And this mixing water is then used to produce new concrete. So what we can do, we can also mineralize the CO2 in this water so we can increase the storage capacity. So we have focused on these two approaches so far. And now going forward, we want to develop also technologies that can be deployed at different sites that have maybe other constraints, but also on other materials that can also be storage media, so concrete, but other mineral waste streams, which could be bottom ashes from waste incinerators, for example.
Okay, thank you, Viola. It sounds that you'll be busy for a while still. Personally, I have great admiration for startups. It's not so easy to have an idea and then really make it work. It needs a lot of effort and a lot of dedication. So That's I find that always fascinating. And I think also SMEs are so important to innovation, because almost every big company, of course, in the end originated from a really small company. I'm pretty sure that our next panelist will probably agree to that. Our next panelist is Carina Faber. She is program manager for cleantech at the European Innovation Council. The EIC supports startups, and as a public funding institution with a budget of about 10 billion euros, one of the EIC priorities is to ensure the support of innovative businesses in cleantech. So Carina, what is your work in CCS?
Thank you very much for this nice introduction. Do you share the slides, or
You should get slides very soon, I think.
Okay, good. Yeah. So thanks for the presentation already of the European Innovation Council. So at the EIC, per year, we support innovation, so deep tech innovation, with around 1.3 billion. And we support areas ranging from health to biotech to space, quantum technologies, and also to energy. And in the clean tech or energy technologies, we fund a broad range of different technologies because we think there are different pathways which could really help to reach that vision of this renewable driven circular economy in 2050, like we have it written down in the Green Deal. And so next to technologies like novel PV systems contributing to massive electrification from renewables up to energy efficiency, I very much focus on everything which is circularity and where carbon dioxide really becomes a resource. So I'm less on this storage issue, but capturing carbon and then using it as a resource for example, renewable fuels and chemicals, that's really at the heart of my activities. And if
thank
in the next
you,
slide
you.
We don't see how the EIC does that in practice. So for those who don't know the European Innovation Council, don't worry, it's still a very novel instrument. It's within Horizon Europe. And so we are in Pillar 3. And Victor, you already very well stated our mission to bring innovation really to the market. And then on the next slide, there's our tools. So you could think that we only fund really mature concepts, but that's not the case. We really go, or we fund along the whole innovation chain. And so also at the EIC, you will find collaborative projects on the low TRL, that's called the Pathfinder. We have also then to bridge the first valley of death, the transition tool. And then what's more important today is we have a dedicated tool to startups where we really try to help them to scale up their prototypes to go to the market. It's dedicated to small and medium enterprises, and we can either give grant funding, equity funding, or a blending. And our funding ranges from 2.5 to 15 million in these cases. You can come to us with any idea you have. So that would be then part of the open calls, or you look out for dedicated calls. So 50% of the budget is distributed via challenge calls. So there it's really top-down challenges, which the program managers conceive, where we really want to tackle specific issues where we see there's a strong need to support SMEs or R&I in that field.
Mm-hmm. And do you perceive that CCS is different from other topics, or
yes,
is it pretty much the same?
Yeah, for us, it's a very promising area, but and both, as also Paul said, so capturing it from industrial waste streams, which is more the low-hanging fruit, but also from air, then in the really long-term vision. And we see that there's, on the one hand, really a strong political will nowadays since these last 2 years to deploy, for example, alternative fuels and chemicals made from the CO2 to capture and utilize CO2, and also to make EU now independent of fossil fuels. And we see what's really nice is that the landscape of the explored technologies is really broad. So we have the choice. And we also saw that in this first presentation from adsorption to chemical, even to biology. And we have no designated winner. And I also agree with Paul. It's really great that we have so rich technologies out there. And what we see then with our applicants is that there is innovation is still needed. also in the sense, I always say integration is innovation. So sometimes it's perceived that integrating concepts into other concepts or using then different technologies is not so innovative, but I think it's really necessary in that field. And what we also see with this broad landscape of technologies, there's really a strong need to identify the most promising ones somehow to support the right technology providers. And that's also, sometimes we now read also in the press that the field is a bit a hype. And I think we should avoid that. So overselling different technology providers, because that doesn't help us from our side to really find out where we should put the money on and to really create also trust with the investors. So one thing is for the accelerator tool, you face a jury by external people experience in investment. So often they come from VCs and they are our experts and you talk to them. So they are not necessarily tech developers, but really from VC and
And then for startups, so you already said a challenge is maybe getting to convince the jury. But so what are the main challenges for startups in this sector?
So that I put on the next slide. What we see is also in the discussions we have then with these jury members, which are not necessarily from that field, is that it's difficult to convince that there is a huge future market, but at the moment your product you will sell is really not price competitive. On the other hand, you really need huge CapEx investments to get to your first pilots, to make it run, to get real values for your techno-economic analysis. And there's also this great uncertainty with the legislation. It's getting better because we get more and more legislation, and that also makes then investors a bit more confident, but it's not fully in place. And so what I also then always try to promote during these interviews is that the market is not ready. And in that field, we really need a de-risking with our public funding somehow to make it easier than for startups.
Clear. Okay. So
I have the next slide. And how we think at the EIC we could help startups in the field of carbon capture. So I think, and I also agree with Paul, we now have to move to this large scale demonstration projects. What we would like to see from our side is, of course, not only first generation tested out at large scale, but also innovative technologies tested. And to make them the SMEs ready to go there and to be included in large scale projects like the Innovation Fund projects, we have what we can do from the EIC side is we have this, as I said, the pathfinder and transition where we can, for example, scout for novel capture processes, or a trend we see is also this combined carbon capture and conversion to really get better energy efficiencies, for example. And then in the accelerator, to really test out the prototype with our, the funding we have and to de-risk it, to have a bit really good idea about the operation procedures, to have validated performances, and then that then gives also confidence to those who set up these large scale projects to include one of these startups.
Okay, thank you so much. Then our last but not least panelist is Chris Davies. He is the director of CCS Europe, but also former a member of the European Parliament and rapporteur for the CCS directive. We heard already that apart from financial support, another way of helping develop technologies is clear regulation. We heard Carina also already mention legislation is getting better. That is good for companies. In your experience, what effect has regulation had in CCS and its technological development?
Well, the only reason we'll do carbon capture and storage is because we need to avoid emissions going into the atmosphere, and in order to capture some of the CO2 already in the atmosphere. And that's driven by regulation, because there's no other commercial reason to make it happen. If it wasn't for the climate change goals, no one would be wanting to capture CO2. The important thing to remember, though, is that we are hopelessly behind where we should be. When I took the CO2 storage directive through the European Parliament and the negotiating processes, that was back in 2008. That regulation suggests that we should be storing 170 million tons of CO2 by 2030. And yet, even as we're talking now, the Council is looking at the proposed Net Zero Industry Act, which is now setting a target of just having the capacity to store 50 million tons by 2030. So we've missed out a huge number of years. And you always see this in that graph you showed of the number of applications for patents, which really reflects the business case that has been for CCS. The business case was fundamentally driven by the emissions trading system, the price of carbon. And of course, the price of carbon collapsed. Now it's come well back up, is expected to carry on increasing. Free allowances are coming to an end. There was a clear business case being developed for CCS investment, but we are way behind where we should be.
Okay, clear. I think that's fair consensus between many of the panelists, I think, is that the CCS should really start to accelerate quite fast now.
Yeah, you say that, but just what do you mean by that? Because I don't think most politicians in most member states, and it will be member states, the Commission's got a good role in laying down some regulatory instruments like the storage directive, the safe storage, and of course CBAM protecting companies from overseas competition if they put up their price to pay for CCS. But it is fundamentally member states that will drive forward CCS development by setting targets and developing strategies and putting in place financial support mechanisms for first movers. But the scale, we're talking about the President of the European Commission saying earlier this year that we need to be storing annually 300 million tons of CO2 within the Union by 2050. Currently, apart from a few pilot projects and excluding Norway outside the EU, we're not storing anything. The first final investment decision for a full chain CCS project was only taken this year. Kalundborg in Denmark to capture and store 430,000 tons of CO2. We need a project of this scale, which is going to cost about €1 billion. We need a project of this scale about every 12 days somewhere in the European Union for the next 25 years. The scale up required to meet our ambitions is enormous. And besides other things, a point was raised to me yesterday, do we even have the capacity, the engineering capacity, to scale up with such huge ambitions? Lots of work to be done.
Yeah, so the ambitions are, a little bit ahead of the reality at the moment. From your experience working in the CCS space, is there sort of a low-hanging fruit? Because I heard low-hanging fruit also from one of the other members that you think would be the most effective way forward, because clearly, there is a big gap.
Well, it's not that there aren't low-hanging fruits. The difficulty is getting to them. I mean, clearly production of ammonia and fertilizers and areas where really the CO2 hardly needs to be expensively separated, but can be captured. But if you haven't got the transport and infrastructure network there, then you can't tap into these. I know one of the issues you want to look at is small scale too. I mean, clearly they're the big cement factories, perhaps 200 across Europe, which will need to be equipped with carbon capture equipment over the next 25 years. Hence the difficulties in just finding the engineering capacity to do that job. And of course, there's lime and aluminium and steel and many chemical facilities too. But if you can build up a transport network, which is available, as for example, may be soon available around Rotterdam, where the Portos project has now got approval for transport and storage infrastructure, maybe you can start to tap into smaller installations, more energy intensive companies that maybe have some, in some cases, alternatives to CCS as a means of reducing their emissions. But if you actually have the facility of a pipeline nearby, then, and the carbon capture costs are being brought down as a result of innovation, then, the opportunities start to open up.
So it's not only innovation and new technologies that we need to look up, but also clearly in things like infrastructure, and engineering capacity, basically, that are holding back.
That's going to be driven by member states. I mean, if member states are going to have to put in place the right financial support mechanisms, they need to facilitate permitting processes. It's difficult to get, you know, permits for pipelines and the like. And in some cases, maybe they need to take a direct lead. There's no reason, of course, why just like with many gas infrastructure systems, a government can't set up its own quango, if you like, organization to take a lead in providing the transport arrangements, pipelines or support for other mechanisms to move the CO2.
Okay, thank you. Then, from my side, a general question. I heard direct air capture. Paul was not a really big fan of that, and I think me myself, being a chemical technologist, I can understand that taking CO2 from a very concentrated point source is much easier than taking a really tiny quantity out of air. Yet, one of the bigger applicants that we see in the CCS area is doing this, and it seems to be popular. Is there any explanation for why direct air capture is nevertheless so popular among investors, for example? Is there anyone who would like to? Paul, I see your hand raised. Please go ahead.
I mean, I would say that it's popular because it is easy to explain, and because it sounds like a good idea. Oh, we could just take the CO2 out from the air. We don't have to rely on fossil fuels. We can do all of these sorts of things. But just because something sounds easy and sounds like it's a good idea doesn't make it a good idea.
All right.
Yeah.
Thank you, Chris.
No. Oh, just over quickly. I mean, I agree with Paul in saying that, if you like, direct air capture is overhyped at the moment. It's clearly, if you've got a huge point of emission of vast quantities of CO2 from an industrial source, that's got to be the priority, surely, stopping it going up in the first place. But the other question that comes to me is why is it, given the scale of investment required, given the huge commercial opportunities, billions and billions of euros will be spent on building the equipment necessary, the transport equipment, the capture equipment. Why aren't so more of the big engineering companies coming up and really advocating for CCS, working with the politicians in member states to drive forward the policies? Because I don't see it. They seem to be sort of waiting for. They seem to be waiting year after year for someone else to create opportunities which are going to, you know, make them rich. Don't understand that.
Yep. Thank you. I think I would. Yeah, Viola, I see your.
Yeah, can I add?
Sure.
This?
Go ahead.
I agree with Paul that direct air capture, well, it's a good storyline. It's a catchy story, but direct air capture with storage, as any other negative emission technology, can deliver negative emissions, and those will be needed to offset those sectors that are hard to abate, like, for example, agriculture. We don't have alternatives to decarbonize that, so we have to compensate for those emissions, and that is where and when direct air capture and other negative emissions technologies will play a role. So I agree, we have to reduce, we have to install CCS for cement plants, waste to energy chemical plants, and then negative emissions will play a role.
Carina, I think you also wanted to say, I love that the panelists themselves start raising their hands already without me having to say anything. So, Carina, I think you...
Yeah, I also wouldn't be so categoric about the direct air capture. I think it's all a thing about the timeline. In short and medium term, of course, it's from industrial sources. But if you really take it serious and reduce them more and more, and we will end up then with the hard-to-abate sectors, and we're really serious for these negative emissions, then we should already prepare for, in, I don't know, 40 years to have some capturing from air. Even, I agree, I'm also a physicist, it's stupid to let it first out of the chimney and then capture it, but from the all these decentralized sources, perhaps there's no other choice.
No, so it's a potential tool in a whole toolbox of several technologies that especially in the long term may be interesting. Is that
But of course, it's true that we can't reach net zero unless we're reducing the CO2 concentrations already in the air. Yep. So can we hear from Paul? I mean, okay, Paul, you're being skeptical about DACs, direct air capture, but what about BECCS? What about capturing the CO2 from biogenic sources?
I was actually just about to say that BECCS might be a better solution. I mean, BECCS, you're looking at maybe...
Maybe could you very shortly explain BECCS, because not everybody who's joining is
biomass enhanced carbon capture and storage, right? So you're growing trees, etc. You're then burning them in a power station, or other ways can happen, but the simplest way is burn it in a power station, capture the CO2 there. So while the trees are growing, they've captured CO2, and then you take that CO2, capture it yourself, put it underground.
The problem is really the capture efficiency, you know? You need such a big land footprint compared to direct air capture facilities.
It uses a third the energy of a direct air capture facility. So will be a significant problem. I'm not saying that, you know, I think we should minimize the requirements for air capture, however it's done, whether it's done directly or with BECCS, but I think we are going to have some agricultural residues, etc., that we can use. And we don't, I don't think we have the energy to go on to direct air capture. BECCS, essentially, when you actually look at the costs, you're looking at maybe £50 per tonne of CO2, whereas direct air capture, I've done studies and looked at siting direct air capture systems all around the world, and the very best you can do with all of your levers pushed to make it as good as possible is about £250 a tonne. It's phenomenally expensive. And my view is that we need to focus on the solutions that are going to be done in the next 20 or 30 years, not the ones that are going to require in the next 40 years. Get carbon capture on plants. Then you can think about advanced CCS, which I've been working in for a while. And then you can think about looking at air capture, these sorts of things. You don't need to be looking at a technology for 40 years in the future when we have so many problems that need solutions right now. We have to get these deployed.
Yeah. I mentioned that the first CCS project, the one that's got the first one to get a final investment decision, is in Denmark. It's Kalundborg. It happens to be a BECCS project, burning in power stations wood and straw. Capturing the CO2, storing the CO2 permanently, removing it. And indeed, as a result of that, Microsoft are investing in it because they want to get negative emissions to compensate for all the CO2 generated by their servers.
I'm sorry, but we knew in advance that the time would be relatively short with a one hour event. And we have promised also a Q&A to members of the audience. I think we've arrived to the moment that we have to go there, which and one of this is a shame because I love a good discussion. We have a panel discussion, we have actual good discussion going on. Eventually we are gonna have to get to the Q&A still and try to be a little bit on time. So I loved the opportunity to moderate this. Time flew by as it were, and it was great. I know that I learned a lot. I hope the audience did as well. I would now like to go over to the Q&A if possible. I understand we have a lot of questions. We may have too many questions more questions than we can answer at this session. So questions that are not answered live can also be sent to the observatory at observatory@epo.org. We will then take them into account. The first question that we got is a question to Chris. Chris, you were rapporteur of the CCS directive in 2008 on the geological storage of carbon in Europe. And one of the participants wanted to know, are there enough capacities for geological storage in view of what should be achieved with regards to carbon neutrality?
Well, I'm not a geologist, but the geologists assure me that there was more than enough capacity for hundreds of years. I mean, I don't regard CCS as I'm not promoting CCS or advocating for CCS because I think it's a wonderful technology. I would like to find alternatives to capturing the CO2 and shoving it into rock deep underground. I think it's perfectly reasonable to do it. We do it with gas, methane, for example, on the temporary basis, and no one worries about it at all. But CO2 being put underground is seen as us dealing with a waste product, even if it's a fairly benign waste product. I hope we will not be having to do this in 100 years' time or 200 years' time, because new technologies will have come along and we'll be exploiting those instead. But as far as I can see, there is no foreseeable problem with CO2 storage capacity, except in certain countries. I mean, some countries, the geology is better than others.
Yeah, clear. Thank you. Then there was a question which I think is more for Carina, which is, can the EIC also support matchmaking for startups with larger companies?
Yes, so I just answered it also in the chat. So we have dedicated tool on that. So if you want to become beneficiary at the EIC, you have access to our business acceleration services. It's a broad range of activities, including a so-called corporate day, where a corporate, we already had one with Engie, for example, invites then startups and for a matchmaking discussion. And we also have the same with the public procurers, which is a procurer day. So, and before the startups can get a training on how to pitch and so on.
Okay, thank you. And then, in view of the time, I think we come to the last question. It's a question to Paul. That's the question, is there a measure like amount of energy per quantity of carbon captured? And how is it evolving over time? I think that's probably depends a bit on the technology, but nevertheless, so the question is there an amount of energy per quantity of carbon captured, and how is it evolving over time?
Yeah, so I just looked this up when I was, so we have a paper a while back, which says for liquid solvents, actually it wasn't one of our papers, it was quoted in a review paper that we did. So for liquid solvents, I'm just looking at the data, and for the sort of benchmark, which is monoethanolamine, that started out as about 5 megajoules per ton of CO2 per ton of CO2 stripped off from wherever and pumped up to the correct pressure. It was in 2014 down to about 3. So it's come down by quite a lot. And the minimum possible is about 1. So, there's still plenty of room to go at. Interestingly, a lot of the reductions have been through not inventing new solvents and deploying new solvents. It's through better understanding of heat integration, better process engineering, which, of course, is patentable as well, but a little bit more difficult to get through a patent, so it was 5, now 3, still on the way down.
Okay, thank you. I think with that sort of encouraging thought, in view of the time, we're going to have to slowly close down. I want to thank again our panelists for taking your time. You were really the soul of this event, and it came through really, really great, I think. As a relative outsider myself, it seems CCS is quite a rich ecosystem with lots of possibilities and still up in the air, but it's also quite relevant that it starts really to accelerate quite soon. I'll take the opportunity to also thank everybody at the Observatory for the great work that you've done in organizing this. I think we've brought the CCS community perhaps a bit closer to the patent community. We've also shared some patenting insights with the CCS community, and I think in working on that interface is exactly what the observatory is meant to do. So bravo. We had now maybe a little bit better idea of the solutions for the future for our planet and for coming generations. CCS are certainly not the only solution to our climate challenges. I think that's clear. To everyone, but I think we've learned that they may have to play a key role in the future. And we've foreseen a little bit the future. Let's make it a reality. Thank you. And then I would like to take the opportunity here now to draw your attention of the participants to our EPO Observatory activities taking place in 2024. I think there's a slide for this. Yeah, so these are some of the things you may still expect from the observatory. If we start at the bottom left, there will be coming out a study and an Espacenet platform on innovation against cancer, followed by, or also in that same semester, there is a study on commercialization of technology relating to the EU Green Deal. And there will be a study on water. And as Espacenet platform, think not only drinking water desalination, but also, for example, protection against water. And in this and space-related inventions conference and a new Espacenet platform. And in the second semester of 2024, we have a study on the commercialization of university patents in Europe and a dashboard of their findings. Energy transition study, I think that's mainly related to grid enhancement and smart grids. And financing of innovation that involves mapping and visualization and knowledge on financing. With that, I'd say it looks both challenging and interesting, I would say. So I'm left then with the next slide. Where I will thank the audience so much for your kind and numerous virtual attendance. It was really great. And I remind you that the activities of the observatory and the recording of the event are available from the observatory website, www.epo.org/observatory. Thanks again to everyone and bye-bye.
Bye. Have a nice day.